Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by
Microjig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, we've brought ourselves back down to the shop, and we're gonna start talking about going through the stack of lumber that we purchased for this project, picking out the right pieces, and even a little bit about rough dimensioning them. Now, I do want to mention before we get further into this, this is going to be a little bit of a talky episode again, just like the last one, although I do have some obligatory action scenes here and there, but for sure, this is definitely one that's going to be a little bit more of a lecture. And one more thing I want to mention, and I completely forgot about this in the last episode, we have a great set of plans that our good friend Brian Benham put together for us. These look absolutely gorgeous, very detailed, everything you're going to need to know, including some of the joinery. And to be honest with you, I'm going to do my darndest to stick to these plans because I think they look fantastic and I want us all to be on the same page as we're going through this. If I do end up tweaking something along the lines, you'll be sure to know all about it, and you could potentially make those changes if you see value in making those changes. One thing that Brian did a really good job of was putting together the parts list for the entire project, and that was based on the components list and stuff, the materials list that I created once I was doing the design work. And in fact, what he did was he put in here the finish dimensions, which are fantastic because, again, you're going to be able to follow along with them in the plans. But at this point, when I have my rough lumber, I want to kind of avoid using those finished dimensions, and I'll explain a little bit more why that is in just a second. But first, I want to talk about bringing the stack in and some of the first steps that we actually take with it. So you might have heard the furnace was running as I was getting started with this. It's February in Michigan right now. It's cold. The shop is much warmer. So this is the time of year that for sure when I purchase my lumber, I bring it in, I let it acclimate before I begin working with it. But during the acclimation process, in my mind, this is the perfect time to start going through the stack, sorting it and saying, you know what, if, for example, in this case, I'm gonna be painting this dresser, but if I was to be putting on some sort of clear finish, I wanna find the components that are gonna work the best together. What I mean by that is, I want to look at the colors. I want to look at the grains of the wood and say, you know, this particular component really needs to have all of its material matched together. So, for example, maybe the top of the dresser or maybe the drawers. I'm looking for all the woods that are going to be exactly very, very similar, if not the same in color, and then especially in the grain pattern, if that's something I want to be really worried about. So at this point, I'll then start going through the stack and saying, you know what, okay, so these colors work really, really great, so let's kind of keep them together. And even though it's in its rough form, you eventually kind of start to see the grains in the rough form, so you know that, okay, now this one is a little too wild for this particular component, so I'm not going to worry about it, and this one's a little too subdued for something where I want, you know, a little bit more pizzazz or something. So that's one of the things I end up doing while I'm waiting for the lumber to acclimate. Another thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go through that parts list that we have here. In fact, let me just go ahead and grab this. I'm going to be referring to it later on. I'll go through the parts list, and even though these are the finished dimensions, I can say, all right, I know for a fact that I want this one particular component to be X number of inches wide, and so this board isn't even close to that, and this board isn't even close to that. So I can start, again, picking out boards that are going to be perfect for very specific components. And that really, really helps me out also in the sense that I can say, not to bring in the camera a little bit closer here, but this particular board has a little bit of a wany edge on here. The bark's all gone, but it's definitely different than the rest of it. And there are, of course, always components that are going to kind of be hidden away, secondary components that are nobody's really going to ever notice them. So that's one of those things where I can take maybe lumber that is slightly flawed or doesn't quite fit into the whole project, maybe because of the color or something, and I can say, well, this is a perfect piece that would be good for a hidden away component. So that is definitely one of the things I do while I'm waiting for my lumber to acclimate. So now that I've taken the time to go through the stack and grab the boards that are probably going to be much better for more highly visible components versus ones that would be better for, say, secondary components, and I have a rough idea of what I want to use these particular boards for, I then start kind of drawing out what I am going to use those boards for. And of course, this is all still in the rough state. So looking at this stack here, I do have everything kind of cut up already. You'll see more about that in just a second. But before I get to that part, what I end up doing is, again, going back to my parts list, and I'll look at it and say, okay, well, I know that I'm going to need, like, 12 front and back frame rails, and they need to be approximately 2 inches wide and 38.5 inches long. So I'll look at those rough boards and say, okay, well, this particular board is wide enough that I can probably get 3 of those 2-inch wide components out of it. And so I then turn to something as simple as, say, like a lumber crayon here, which is really nothing more than just a big thick wax crayon. Or I'll use like white chalk or even like a really thick carpenter's pencil, anything that helps me to literally draw the lines out and lay them out on the rough boards so that I get a feel for exactly how many components from each board I can get. Now, when I'm doing this, one thing I mentioned, I want to stay away from those finished dimensions. So again, in this example, I talked about how I need to have 12 of the front and back frame rails, and they're going to be approximately 2 inches. When I'm working in the rough state, when I'm doing this rough dimensioning, I always like to add at least 1/4 to 1/2 inch on each one of those dimensions in width, and then maybe even like 1 inch or so on length, so that I can accommodate for things like, one, having to joint it to a nice straight edge and then having to rip it so it's parallel with that edge, or in the case of adding a little bit more to each length. The main reason for that is, one, just in case there's any checking that happens during the process. Who knows, you might actually discover that when you cross cut a board, it may just for some reason have enough tension in there that it splits a little bit, so it gives you a little wiggle room in there. And of course, more importantly, when we get to the thickness planer, let's get serious. Sometimes we're going to run into little snip, whatever you want to call it. And by having that little extra room at either end, you can accommodate for it. So then when you go to your finished dimensioning afterwards, you can then remove it and your boards are now exactly where you want it. So, and this also really gives you a chance to even kind of play around with the components. So if you're looking for a very specific grain, and maybe you want something that's nice straight grain, but the board actually has it kind of angling off, you can adjust how you want that to work, and then you can come in and cut it out as needed. So working in the rough lumber, with the rough lumber this way, really gives you the opportunity to pick and choose the exact boards that you want for your project. So you can see why I like to purchase just a little bit extra lumber, say like that 25-30%. It's not only for the oops factor in case I make a mistake, which inevitably I'm going to end up doing and I'll need to recut a component, but it also has a lot to do with when I do my rough dimensioning. Again, I like to just kind of leave that wiggle room in there for making sure I've got enough material to remove, say at the jointer, at the thickness planer, or when I come in here and do my ripping either on the table saw or the band saw. I want to make sure I've got more than enough room in there to accommodate for all of those things. So that's really something important to think about when you start purchasing your lumber and when you're putting together your cut list. Another thing to think about when you are laying out the boards, if you choose to do it this way, what I would like to do is I like to batch everything together. So say those drawer rails, if possible, I like to get 2 or 3 of them together, because then when I cross cut, and I like to cross cut with my handsaw, but you could use like a jigsaw or a circular saw or something. But that way, when I make that cross cut, 9 times out of 10, they're all going to be at the same length, and I now have batched together 2 or 3 components with 1 single cut. Another thing I'm always looking at when I look at my component list is, how long are some of the boards? How big are they? If I were to cut them out individually, even at that rough dimension, is it safe to run them through tools like, say, the thickness planer? There are certain limitations on what you can run through, because if it's too small, it could literally potentially get severely damaged in the machine, damage the machine, or even get thrown out at you, and we just don't want stuff like that happening. So if you have a project that has several smaller pieces, go ahead and batch them up so that it's at a length that's safe enough to be able to run them through the tools and get the results that you want. So once I have everything drawn, it's time to start doing the cross cutting again with the handsaw. And then when it comes to components like these, of course, I had them all batched up in one single board. These drawer rails, it was just a matter of now going over to my bandsaw. And I prefer to do my rough cutting on the bandsaw, say, versus at my table saw. Again, I could use a jigsaw, I could potentially use a circular saw, or I could use a handsaw, but I find the bandsaw just works really well for me. I get great results. And I just use that to start kind of going through and, again, rough dimensioning the boards for me so that I'm all set to go on to something now, like moving over to the jointer and then running things through this thickness planer, which I'm not going to do in this episode because I think it's already starting to run a little long. But for sure, when we get ready to come into the next episode, I'll have everything jointed and everything ran through the thickness planer, and we'll be all set so we can start then running everything into its finished dimensions, which now that we have everything in place, we've got it down to those finished thicknesses and stuff. It's so much easier to do, and we're going to get the results that we want once we start putting everything together. So that's where we're going to pick up in the next episode. So until then, if you have comments, questions, suggestions, I love hearing from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. You can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com and leave a comment over there in the show notes. Or if you're watching this at YouTube, please feel free to leave a comment there. I love, again, hearing from all of you. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.